Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Welcome to Reflection. I'm your host, Imam Suhaib Webb. This is our third important show. As you recall, last time we were talking about Surah Al-Fatiha, this incredible surah, which is basically like a small lake, a small pond of all of the guidance found in the Quran, a zip file of the Quran, if you will. And we talked about Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. If Surah Al-Fatiha is a zip file of the Quran, then Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is a zip file of Surah Al-Fatiha. And I want to mention two important lessons about the Basmala. One of them I talked about last time, but I want to add a little bit to it. And then the second one I think that's really, really going to blow your mind, inshallah, and really cause you to say, Subhanallah, how lucky we are to be Muslims, how lucky we are to be able to read the Quran and hold this everlasting miracle of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our hands. You know, this statement, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, is so incredible, is so powerful that some ulama, some of the scholars, they said about this surah that all of Islam in its entirety, all of the Sharia that was sent to the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is found in this powerful statement. As you recall, I mentioned two important lessons that we take from this surah. Number one is breaking bad habits. This chapter of the Quran empowers us to break bad habits. But most importantly, this verse of Quran empowers us to break bad habits. How? I mentioned that last time about the guy who couldn't lower his gaze, and my teacher said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Say that every time you want to look at something wrong. And the brother said, Shaykh, how could I do that? The same thing happened to me once. There was a friend of mine who was a smoker, and he asked me, Suhaib, how can I stop from smoking? I said, every time you want to smoke a cigarette, say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. He said, how on earth am I gonna say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and smoke a cigarette? I said, exactly. So Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, we should call it the habit breaker, something that empowers us to break habits. So anytime you might get mad at your wife, you wanna yell and scream, Astaghfirullah, we see even sometimes people physically harming their wives. You get upset with your husband, you wanna burn the nasi lemak, or you wanna burn the tea tare, or you wanna give him a hard time. You get upset with your children, you get upset with your parents. At school, you get mad at your teacher, at your friends. Before you do something bad, say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. It's the habit breaker. It'll help you break those bad habits. The second thing is truly remarkable. If you look at the number of letters in the Basmala, the number of letters actually are 19. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, the great companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said something unbelievable about this statement. He said, if you count the number of letters in Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, they're 19. You find that's the same number of malaika, that's the same number of angels who are going to punish people in the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, عَلَيْهَا تِسْعَةَ عَشَرَ, talking about the number of angels who will be enforcing adab, and we ask Allah to protect us from the hellfire. He says in Surah Al-Muddathir that there are 19. So Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, whoever wants to be safe from those 19 angels whose job is to punish people in the hellfire, then let them say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, because every letter in the Basmala will be a means to save them from each one of those angels. That is just absolutely incredible. Our show, Reflections on the Quran and Reflections in General, is designed to bring us closer to the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran, to engage the Quran. And after saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, after saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, we move on to this next beautiful verse. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim teaches us about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The entire religion of Islam is founded on rahmah. The entire religion of Islam is founded on bringing good and preventing harm. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said, if you look at any verse where Allah says, Ya arang arang bar iman, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, you'll only find one of two things after that, either an order bringing you a benefit or an order keeping you from harm. So the ulama said that all of Islam is founded on jalb al-masalih wa dar' al-mafasid, bringing benefit and preventing harm. This small statement, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, is bringing benefit and preventing us from harm. And after that ma'rifah, after that tafakkur fi Allah, we move on now to the next beautiful verse. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen is translated as all praise is due to Allah alone, the Lord of everything that exists. Alhamdu actually means to praise something, not because you receive something from it. That's called shukr. So we say a shukr muqabilu ni'mah. You know, if someone gives you something, you say, terima kasih, you know, thank you. But in Arabic, the same thing also applies. If someone does something nice to you, say, shukran, shukran. But when you say alhamd, it's very different. Because the word alhamd does not mean that you say it because you receive something from someone. You say alhamd to something because by its essence, by its nature, by its existence, it demands praise. And this is only applicable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some ulama said that hamd is only with the tongue because Allah says in the Quran, وَقُولِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ. But most of the ulama of Ahlul Sunnah said that alhamd is not only with the tongue, but with the heart and with the limbs. We say alhamdu, and the alif and lam here, al, is incredible. It means every single type of praise. As we break now for commercial break, we're going to return and talk about the different types of people in relationship to praising Allah. Please stay tuned to our important show, Reflections. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
This is Surah Al-Fatiha, the greatest surah in the Quran. The companions of the Prophet chose it to be the beginning of the Quran, and Allah chose it to be repeated 17 times per day in the prayer, and about double this if a person prayed the Sunnah. The prayer would not be acceptable without it. According to the hadith reported by Imams Bukhari and Muslim, the Prophet Muhammad said, "There is no prayer for whom do not read the Fatiha."
Al-Fatiha is the first chapter in Al-Quran.
There are lots of benefits of Surah Al-Fatiha, and one of them is as a guidance for me to do anything in my life.
The most beautiful surah. That's why we recite this surah every time in the salah.
Al-Fatiha is a cure for us when we sick.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Welcome back to Reflection. I'm your host, Imam Suhaib Webb. You can see people offering their suggestions about this beautiful chapter of the Quran, Surah Al-Fatiha. When we say Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, we have to feel from the depths of our heart what we're saying. The L here, Alif Lam, L, means every single type of praise. Every single type of praise, istighraq, Alhamdu. And as I said, the word Alhamd is much more universal than simply terima kasih or shukr. Because alhamdu is not said in response to something good that was done, an act of benevolence, but alhamdu is a sign of ma'rifah, a sign of cognition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, understanding that something deserves this quality of alhamd, fahuwa mahmudun subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why we say alhamdu lillah. Oh, so beautiful. Alhamdu li, here the lam means istihqaq, only to Allah. Every single type of praise belongs exclusively to the realm of the divine, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said something so incredible, man. Alhamdulillahi tamla'ul mizan. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that alhamdulillah will fill the scale. What scale? Not the scale that you look at every morning when you wake up or before you go to sleep. No, this is the scales when we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our scale of good deeds. So the Prophet said, alhamdulillahi tamla'ul mizan. One of the lessons we can take from this is stop cussing. You know, many of our young generations, our young brothers and sisters, because of their exposure to certain types of music and movies, which I understand, you know, is part of being young, part of growing up, but sometimes we adopt the bad customs of these people, the sunan of these people. Here, if we replace cuss words with dhikr, so instead of saying, you know, beep, 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 we can say, alhamdulillah. I had a friend once who used to cuss, And I said to him, instead of cussing, why don't you say Subhanallah? Instead of cussing, why don't you say, you know, Alhamdulillah? He said, why? I said, when you say Subhanallah, the Prophet said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will plant a tree for you in Jannah. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the shadow of that tree would take you 700 years to traverse on the fastest horse. I said, now, when you say beep, 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 for example, bad words, do you get anything in Jannah? He said, no. So he said, I want to do my best. So we were traveling, and suddenly he said, beep, Subhanallah. Or he said, sorry, Subhanallah, beep. He said, Subhanallah, and then a cuss word after it. I said, man, you planted the tree and then you uprooted the tree with your cuss word. So we should say, Alhamdulillah, replace the evil words that we say, the bad words we use, with the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet said, because this statement, Alhamdulillah, tamla'ul mizan. How do we live alhamd? How do we live alhamd? You know, Imam Al-Ghazali, rahimahullahu ta'ala, said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned this beautiful hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves to see the athar, the signs and effects of his mercy on his servants, means through their actions. So when we say Alhamdulillah, the first sign of a good relationship with Alhamdulillah is to be a person who has a positive outlook. We should have a positive outlook. If we realize that all hamd is due to Allah, all thanks is due to Allah, everything that happens is by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything has divine hikmah, which we're not able to understand all the time, we should be positive. Allah says, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُمْ وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah says, perhaps you hate something and it's good for you, and perhaps you love something and it's bad for you. Allah knows and you don't know. So there should be this positive attitude the Muslim should carry. We should live lives of praise. It's one thing to say praise, it's one thing to have the book of praise, but it's quite another thing to be the people of praise, the people of Alhamd. So with this in mind, we have to look at the people of Hamd into three categories. Number one are those who say Alhamdulillah only with their tongue. Only with their tongue. They say Alhamdulillah, but their limbs, their bodies act in contradiction to that statement, Alhamdulillah. And their hearts are asleep. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep our hearts alive. Number two are those who say Alhamdulillah and they perform some of the actions of Alhamd, like giving charity, like praying on time, being clean, being benevolent to the needy and the poor, being merciful to the young, respecting the elders. When they drive down the street and there's a jam, they don't honk their horn and pester other people. No. They live a life of hamd. The third are those people who say Alhamdulillah with their tongues. They live Alhamdulillah. They don't use their body parts for evil, their eyes, their hands, their limbs. And their hearts are completely intoxicated with the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هذا هو, this is the meaning of Alhamdulillah. How to be the people of Alhamd. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls them Alhamidun. Those people who say Alhamdulillah in abundance, but also their hearts are alive with Alhamd and their actions are nothing but a reflection of the manifest incredible mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that has showered every aspect of their life, covering every dry leaf and every dry limb of grass in their hearts and turning it green and healthy with iman, with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is Allah? Allah says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. The word Rabb in Arabic means Lord, Master, Caretaker, the Knowledgeable, the Muhit, the one who surrounds everything with his wisdom, the Mudabbir, the one who controls all. And we say actually in Arabic for a landlord, Rabbu Shaqqa. He's the landlord because he's the Rabb of the apartment. But Allah is what? Rabbul Alameen, the Rabb of everything that exists. The word Al-Alameen comes from the word Al-Alama, which means Alamat. The word Al-Alameen comes from the word Alamat, which means signs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb of signs. What signs? Everything around us, everything that exists, its huduth, its beginning, and its end is all a sign of a sani', of a creator. سبحانه وتعالى. When we say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, we extract one more important lesson that I'll share with you in the future. Right now we're going to take a commercial break. You are watching Reflection with Imam Suhaib Webb. Please stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
This surah, Al-Fatiha, started with praising Allah, and this there is a lesson to thank Allah for the blessings which Allah gave us. Rahman means with great mercy, and Rahim means continuous mercy. And Allah is the owner of the Day of Judgment, and nobody has this as Allah said in Quran. And Allah is the only one that must be worshipped, which contains the meaning of pure Tawhid, oneness. And at the end, there is a prayer to ask Allah His guidance.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Welcome back to our show Reflection. It is great to be with you, completely awesome spending this wonderful time with you. What's interesting is now I have an iPad and I'm actually totally addicted to it. And I had a student once, and this reminds me of something that happened in light of this verse, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. When I first met this student, he came to me and said, I heard that you're a sheikh. I said, I'm a teacher, yeah. He said, well, how can a white guy be a sheikh? I said, well, sheikhs don't just come in the same color or the same clothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Rabbul Alameen. He made everyone in different colors, different shapes, different sizes, different language, you know, different places. Secondly, he said, why do you have an iPad? How can a sheikh have an iPad? I said, what are you talking about? What's cool is who introduced me to the iPad was another sheikh, a friend of mine named Sheikh Abdul Nasser. So I told him, a sheikh is the one who gave me this idea to use the iPad because I put so many Arabic books on here that I can read from. And then he said, how? I said, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Allah is the Lord of everything that exists, even iPads. We take two incredible lessons from this beautiful statement of Allah, Rabbil Alameen. And that is number one. A beautiful principle found in our religion is that everything outside of worship is considered halal unless there's a clear text to prohibit it. This axiom was enunciated by the scholars of Usul who said, "Al-asl fil ashya ibaha," that the origin of things which bring benefit to people is permissible. What does that mean for you and I as Muslims? Not all of us are tuan guru, not all of us are imams, Not all of us are qurra, not all of us are sheikhs. But that doesn't mean that we cannot play a part in being good citizens and being good Muslims. The minarets in the Muslim world were not built by the ulama, they were built by the architects. So maybe as a young Muslim, you're into the arts. Maybe as a young Muslim, you're a rapper. Maybe as a young Muslim, you want to become a businessman. Maybe as a young Muslima, you want to become a fashion designer. All of these things are encouraged by Islam because the asl fil ashya ibaha fima yanfa, because the origin of things is beneficial. Why? Allah is Rabbul Alameen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create al-alameen to keep us from utilizing it. The opposite. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this dunya. وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Allah subjugated this dunya for us to use to worship Him. And that's why Imam Abdul Rahman ibn Jawzi rahimahullah used to say, إِنَّمَا الدُّنْيَا مَزْرَعَةً, that this dunya is like a harvest and you reap from it what you invest. So I want to encourage you as artists, as poets, as fashion designers, as engineers, as doctors, as young professionals, as a crew, as a cameraman, everyone has a part to play in being good Muslims, no matter where they are, no matter what they're doing, because the origin of things is permissibility unless there's a clear text that says it's forbidden. The second lesson that we take from this beautiful statement, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, is to use the best, most up-to-date things in the best, most up-to-date, trying to think of a word, is to use the best, most up-to-date things out there. As Muslims, we should have nice dress, we should have nice technology, we should have the nice car, the nice home. Allah said, وَلَقَدَ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِحَ. Allah decorated the skies with stars. Should the Muslim walk around looking shabby, looking sad, looking depressed? Or should the Muslim have this izzah, this beautiful nature, this beautiful personality? The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam said to his companions, as related by Imam Abu Dawud rahimahullah in his beautiful Sunan, he said, "You are going to see your companions, so dress nice, straighten your saddles, look clean, be fresh, be approachable." Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. After saying Rabbul Alameen, Allah mentions Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. After saying Rabbil Alameen, Allah says Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. The question comes, why would he repeat it again? He said Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, and now he's saying Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim again. The reason is that the word Rabbul Alameen, these words bring about what's called Tarheeb, fear in the heart of a person, that a soul power is Rabb of everything, and nothing shares in him with this power, that's something that should be feared. But he reminds us, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, to soften our hearts, to bring us close to him, to bring us nearer to him, to remind us that in his lordship, he's Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He finishes by saying, Maliki Yawmiddin, and we'll stop here. The last part of this surah that we'll talk about is the statement, Maliki Yawmiddin. Malik, the king, the lord, another qira'ah, Maliki Yawmiddin, which means the king of Yawmiddin. Maliki Yawmiddin implies that there's a day where all of us are going to stand in front of this ultimate power, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and be questioned and be brought to account for how we lived in this life. And he says Yawmiddin, and the word deen actually here means debt, because we call a debt in Arabic dayin, the day of debt, the day we have to respond to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and answer how we lived in this life. And a lesson we take from this important verse for our own spiritual growth, for our own reflection, is to be responsible. We live in an age where people are taught to be perpetually silly, to be perpetually playing around, to gain a sense that they're going to live forever. The longevity of human beings now is the longest it's ever been in history. So we find young men becoming older men later on mentally. But when we say Maliki Yawmiddin, we develop a sense of responsibility. Everything in this life I'm going to be questioned for. We will continue insha'Allah ta'ala in our next episode talking about this beautiful chapter, Surah Al-Fatiha. You're watching Reflection with Imam Suhaib Webb. Thank you for your time, listening and watching. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.